فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا أمرهم من الأعمال بما يطيقون. If he commanded them something, he would command them that which they were able to do. Then they said to him, قالوا إنا لسنا كهيئتك يا رسول الله. O Messenger of Allah, we are not like you. إِنَّ اللَّهَ قَدْ غَفَرَ لَكَ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِكَ وَمَا تَأَخَرَ. Because the Prophet was commanding them to do something easy, take it easy on yourselves, do what you can, and what you're able to do, Some of the Sahaba said to the Prophet, يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, we can actually do more. We're not like you, because you, Rasulullah, you don't have to do much. You're forgiven for your sins, for your upcoming sins, for your past sins. You're forgiven. You're clean on the record. But we're not like that, Rasulullah. So we need to go hard in. Then the narration said, فَيَغْضَبُ حَتَّى يُعْرَفُ الْغَضَبُ فِي وَجْهِهِ ثُمَّ يَقُولُ. Then the Prophet became angry, and the anger could be seen on his face. And he said to them, إِنَّ أَتْقَاكُمْ وَأَعْلَمُكُمْ بِاللَّهِ أَنَا. The one who has the most, and who's the most conscious of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, and who knows Allah the most is who? Is me. وَأَنَا أَعْلَمُكُمْ بِاللَّهِ. That's what Bukhari wants to chapter is. بَابُ قَوْلِ النَّبِيِّ أَنَا أَعْلَمُكُمْ بِاللَّهِ. That's what the relationship between the chapter is. The benefits that we take from the hadith is as follows. The person who's responsible for the people and who's in charge of the people, the person who's responsible and in charge of the people's affairs, he should observe the people's abilities and the people's strength and what they can and can't do. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. Allah does not burden a soul for more than that which it can take. Allah also says, لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا ما آتاها. Allah does not burden a soul more than that which it has been given. So it basically falls under the hadith, من لا يرحم لا يرحم. The one who doesn't show mercy to the creation, Allah won't show mercy to you. The second thing that we take from this hadith is also the Sahabas, how they strove and how they put hard work and effort in the good and in striving towards the good, and how passionate they were. This is something we have to understand, wallahi. Sahaba to Rasulullah were hard workers. If you look at us today, we have to be told, relax. So we have to be told, akhi, what are you doing? You're coming short. The Sahabas were not like that. The Sahabas rather were opposite. They were told to take it easy, calm down, easy, be easy on yourself. فَلِذَلِكَ the Prophet, دَخَلَ الْمَسْجِدِ, he entered the masjid. فَرَأَى, he saw habl, he saw a rope. That rope was tied between two pillars. And so the Prophet looked at the rope and he said, مَلِي هَذَا الْحَبْلِ, whose rope is this? قِيلَ لِزَيْنَبَ, it was said to him, it's Zainab's. This rope is owned by your wife, Zainab. So the Prophet said, what does she do with this? They said, Ya Rasulullah, she prays. When she becomes tired, her legs lose ability, and she can't walk anymore, she can't stand anymore, she ties herself and connects herself to the rope, and her legs dangle. Then the Prophet said, حُلُّهُ, take it off, take this rope off. And he said, فَلْيُصَلِّ أَحَدَكُمْ عَلَى نَشَاطِ, one of you should pray in accordance to his ability. Don't overburden yourself. Now what that hadith shows us is how much they were striving, male and female. Zainab was the Prophet's wife. She was working hard and she was told to take it easy, take it easy. And that's how the companions were, Ridwanullahi alayhim ajma'in. The third benefit that we take from the hadith is what? That somebody who's noble, somebody who's righteous, somebody who's sincere may misunderstand a person's statement. You're good and you intend good, and you are righteous and you're noble. قَدْ يَفْهَمُونَ أُمُورًا لَيْسَتْ عَلَى وَجْهِهَا الصَّحِيحِ. You may understand a matter not how it was really said. Because some of the companions here understood from the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم that which he wasn't trying to hint, nor was he trying to say. But rather the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was coming from the angle of what? أَحَبُّ الْأَعْمَالِ إِلَى اللَّهِ أَدْوَمُهَا وَإِنْ قَلَّ. That the action that's most beloved to Allah is that which is consistent, even if it's little. Islam is about quality, not quantity. It's about quality. Allah loves that which you do every time. You don't stop. You can't memorize the Quran, take an ayah every day. Is that too much? Just be consistent. If you do that for the rest of your life, you'll be finishing the Quran in a very short time. But this is the belief that we have. This is not the belief we have. Our belief is that I have to do a lot or I should leave it. It's either a lot and it has to be something big or it's nothing. And that's not how it is. Okay? ولذلك that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, تبارك الذي بيده الملك وهو على كل شيء قدير الذي خلق الموت والحياة ليبلوكم أيكم أحسن عملا. Not أكثركم عملا. Allah created death and He created life to see the one who has the best of actions, not the one who has the most of actions. It's not the best. It's not the most. It's the best. It's quality. Allah wants the best actions from you. You could be praying Qiyamul Layl for all of the days of your life, but if you're not praying it properly, what's the benefit? Yeah? It's quality. It's, you have to look at quality. Number four. This hadith shows us that the Prophet is virtue. في منقبة لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. The Prophet's virtue. What's the virtue? That he صلى الله عليه وسلم قد غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه وما تأخر. Allah says إنا فتحنا لك فتحا مبينا ليغفر لك الله ما تقدم من ذنبك وما تأخر. The Prophet's past sins and his upcoming are forgiven. Okay, he's clean عليه الصلاة والسلام. Five. This also shows us that the Prophet is a human being. He gets angry just like we get angry. Alayhi salatu wasalam. And that he got angry with his own companions. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam's anger was, his anger was, إِذَنْ تُهِكَتْ مَحَارِمُ اللَّهِ. If Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is maharim, somebody went against Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, this is when he got angry. Alayhi salatu wasalam. Number six is the virtue of knowledge. Because what did the Prophet say? أَنَا أَتْقَاكُمْ وَأَعْلَمُكُمْ بِاللَّهِ أَنَا. I'm better than you guys. I'm more pious than you guys. And I'm more knowledgeable than you guys. So the Prophet is higher than us in knowledge. So he's more virtuous than us. Knowledge has what? Knowledge has high status. High position. Number seven we take from this hadith is the permissibility of praising yourself if there's a need for it. When you want to get a job, you praise yourself by putting down a CV. So, nobody can come to you and say to you, فَلَا تُزَكُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ هُوَ عَلَمُ بِمَنِ اتَّقَى. Don't praise yourself. Allah knows who's pious from amongst you. How am I going to get a job? So, you're allowed to. You're allowed to. And it doesn't fall under قَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى فَلَا تُزَكُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ هُوَ عَلَمُ بِمَنِ اتَّقَى. If you say, for example, I memorized, if you're going for a marriage and they ask you about your credentials and what type, you can say, I memorized the Quran, I know this. Because you're desperate to get married, right? Yeah, brothers. Nah. Number eight, from the benefits that we take from it is what? That sometimes harshness can be shown. Harshness can be shown at times. If the need and the necessity comes with it. Like the Prophet got angry. Alayhi salatu wasalam was being a bit tough with the companions here. You can. Number nine. The permissibility of getting angry. Jazakallah khairan. The permissibility of getting angry in the face of the person you're discussing a matter with. You can. The Prophet did alayhi salatu wasalam. Last but not least, the last one is that stand over the Prophet ﷺ as a lifestyle and how he was as an individual. The majority of the times he was what? Soft, kind and generous and tender. So you don't take these times when he was a bit harsh and tough and make that the general, sah? And make that the general way of the Prophet ﷺ. And also the one who tries to never get angry for the sake of Allah and never shows toughness for the sake of Allah, never does, and rebukes anybody for doing it at all, is also wrong. Both extremes. Naam.
Chapter. Whoever hates to revert to kufr, yani atheism or disbelief, as he hates to be thrown into the fire, is a part of faith. Narrated by Anas radiallahu anhu, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, whoever possesses the following three qualities will taste the sweetness of faith. Number one, the one to whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam become dearer than anything else. Number two, the one who loves a person and he loves him only for Allah's sake. Number three, who hates to revert to disbelief after Allah jalla jalala has brought him out, saved him from it, as he hates to be thrown into the fire.
باب من كره أن يعود في الكفر كما يكره أن يلقى في النار من الإيمان.
الإمام البخاري, look what he did. He's going to bring the same hadith twice. Why does he do that for? He wants to show you that two evidence can be taken out of it. Before he brought it in what? باب حلاوة الإيمان, the sweetness of Iman. And here he's bringing in the chapter the same hadith from the same companion. باب من كره أن يعود في الكفر كما يكره أن يلقى في النار من الإيمان. And now he's trying to take another ruling out of it, which is what? Is that disliking, to go into disbelief, as you would hate to be thrown into the hellfire, is from Iman. Again, this is a branch from the branches of Iman that he didn't take out of when he was talking in the other chapter. The other chapter, what he took from it was what? The sweetness of Al-Iman. Now he's trying to prove that you have to, hating disbelief, okay? And hating to go to disbelief, the way you hate to be thrown into the hellfire. Well, that's why Bukhari, rahimahullah, his tabwibat is a science itself. Are you with me, brothers? He's bringing the same hadith, just different headings, because he wants to take something different from it. But there's another thing he'll do, Bukhari, majority of the times. And that is, before he narrated it from his Shaykh Muhammad ibn al-Muthanna, حدثنا عبد الوهاب الثقفي قال حدثنا أبو أيوب عن أبي قلابة عن أنس بن مالك عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. But this time he will try his hardest not to narrate fully all of those narrators again. He will try to make sure he brings it from another person. Here he brought it from who? Sulaiman ibn Harbin. حدثنا شعبة. And before, instead of شعبة, who was it? It was أبي قلابة. No, أبو أيوب. نعم, أبو أيوب السجستاني we spoke about. أبو أيوب السختياني, sorry, ابن أبي تميمة. Here he brought the narration of who? قتادة من الدعامة السدوسي. And Anas رضي الله تعالى عنه. Also, this hadith right now is what? Is shorter in terms of chain than the previous one. نعم. So there's no need for us to go into the hadith. We've already taken it.
Chapter. The grades in superiority of the believers will be according to their good deeds. Narrated by Abu Sa'id al-Khudri رضي الله عنه, that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, when the people of paradise will enter paradise and the people of hell will go into hell, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will order those who have had faith equal to the weight of a grain of a mustard seed to be taken out from the hellfire. So they will be taken out, but by then they will be blackened and charred. Then they will be put into the river of Haya or Hayati. The narrator is in doubt as to which is the right word. And they will revive like a grain that grows near the bank of a flood channel. Don't you see that it comes out yellow and twisted? Wuhayb stated, when narrating to us, Amr radiallahu anhu used the word hayati. Moreover, he said, goodness equal to the weight of a grain of a mustard seed.
Babu, tafadli ahli al-imani min al-a'mal.
Here, Bukhari rahimahullah, he talks about that the people of Iman, they are of different stations, we're not all the same, in terms of our actions. So this is the two meanings that scholars, they took from it. It's one of two reasons. One of two meanings that he means by Bukhari. The first one is بَابُ بَيَانُ تَفَاوُتُهُمْ فِي الْأَعْمَالِ, that the people are different in actions. Like somebody will do an action and somebody likes to do another action. They're just different in their actions. Are you there? Does that make sense? It's just that they're different in terms of their actions, generally speaking. Somebody just likes to fast and another person likes to? It's sadaqah. Somebody likes voluntary sadaqah. Allah is open, so not everybody's the same, right? Some scholars, they say that's maybe why he got it here. And that all the actions are not of one level for that person. Maybe you like to fast. Maybe somebody else prefers to pray a lot. Another person may like to give sadaqah a lot. Another person likes to go to umrah and hajj a lot. You're all the same in the reward that you come with, but you're doing different actions. That's one. The second one is, which is what he means, is that the iman here is different due to people's actions. I pray more than you pray. Or even if when you fast, I fast more than you, مثلاً. Or you fast more than I do. And you pray more than I do. And because you do something more than I do, and you come with more quality in it, then here we start passing each other. And this tafadul can be amalul qalb, and it can also be the amalul jawarih. It can be the actions of the heart, and it can also be actions of the limbs. For instance, we all prayed Maghrib together with the same imam. Let's just say, hypothetically, I prayed now at Maghrib on the front line. Okay, I tried to, but no one was letting me through. Yeah? I gave everyone a look, please let me through. They just wasn't. But the first line, we all pray. Okay? Everybody in that front line, were they the same in reward? We all said Allahu Akbar together at the same time. We all pray behind the same imam. We all pray in the same masjid. We all. But do you think everyone in the front line was the same? Nah, they're not the same. Some are doing it, their ikhlas, and their khushu' and their tadabbur, and their fakkur. Everything is high. Another person is gone. He's cleaning the houses, he's gone to other people's houses, he's visiting his cousins, he's coming back when the imam goes, Allahu Akbar, that's when he comes back. But he's in the front line. Sah? Another individual is what? He's not even praying properly physically. He's throwing his hands wherever he goes. You see, he just throws himself on the floor. He doesn't pray properly. Are you there, brothers? So that action alone that everyone is doing, yatafawatun, their levels of it. They're not the same. One's amalul qalb is high, one is amalul jawarih is high, and etc. That's what Bukhari is trying to show here. Good. Faddal.
Haddathana Ismail. Qal, haddathani Malikun.
Ismail is who? Ibn Abi Awais. And he is the Ibn Ukht Imam Malik. He is the son, he's the nephew of Imam Malik. And he is from the Rijal of Bukhari who are al-mutakallamu fihim. They have been spoken against. This man is being spoken against. There's two scholars who even Bukhari, they tried to get things out of Bukhari. They didn't let Bukhari get away with it. From those scholars as Imam al-Daruqutni. Daruqutni, he followed up narrations in Bukhari and Imam Muslim and tried to find weak narrations in there. He tried. Abu Mas'ud al-Dimishqi also did the same. Abu Mas'ud al-Dimishqi, second person. Are you there? He has a book, Tatab'u al-Iltizam, and all those. They followed up narrations. So from the narrators that have been spoken against is this narrator, Ismail ibn Abi Awais, who is the nephew, Ibn Ukht, Imam Malik, rahimahullah ta'ala, and he is min Rijal al-Bukhari. And what's actually even shocking is that it is from the what? Bukhari brings him in what? Fi sulb al-Kitab. He doesn't bring them as a mutaba'at. He doesn't bring them as a backup. He actually uses this narration particularly for a tabweeb. And it's this narrator. So how do we help Bukhari here? Majority, I'm going to give you guys a general qa'idah, memorize this. The scholars, when they see narrators that Bukhari brings in his sahih that have been spoken against, are you there? The majority of those people who have been spoken against Bukhari, are you there? The most majority of them are people who he doesn't bring them as a shawahid. He doesn't use them as an evidence. Or he doesn't use them as a sulbul mawdu'. He doesn't use them in the topic at hand. He uses them as a mutaba'at. The majority of them are like that. The overwhelming majority of narrators that he's been criticized for narrating from them are from minbabil mutaba'at. Very good. That's one. The second answer the scholars give is that even that same person that Imam al-Bukhari brought, intaqa min ahadithihi ma saha minha. He handpicked from that individual. He's weak, right? But doesn't the weak person get it right sometimes? Does he not? Even the liar lies, he's not always lying. He sometimes tells the truth, right? Sah? Let alone a person, these people who have been criticized by Bukhari are not liars, by the way. And their criticism has nothing to do with their integrity, their memory. Okay, it's their memory. Are you with me, brothers? From those people who he has narrated from, he has cherry-picked them, hand-picked them. He's looked into his narrations, and whatever he found that were right, from external evidences he found, he took chose from them. So he didn't narrate every time from him. Does that make sense, brothers? So these are min intiqa min ahadithi ma sahha minha. And then he placed it in his sahih. Haddathani Malikun, whose name is what? Malik ibn Anis, Imam Dari Hijra. Now.
An Amr ibn Yahya al-Mazini. An Abihim. An Abi Sa'id al-Khudri radiyallahu anhu. عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال يدخل أهل الجنة الجنة وأهل النار النار ثم يقول الله تعالى
The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم he tells us يدخل أهل الجنة the people of Jannah will enter Jannah and the people of Nar will enter Nar. This now refers to عموما سواء الكافر it can either be the disbeliever or it also involves المسرف على نفسه من المسلمين. This hadith is saying, يَدْخُلُ أَهْلِ الْجَنَّةِ الْجَنَّةِ That the people of Jannah will enter Jannah, and the people of Nar will enter Nar. The part that says that the people of Nar will enter Nar, it involves the kuffar, and it also involves the Muslims who've transgressed. The Muslims who've transgressed and exceeded their limits. The ones we mentioned, ثُمَّ أَوْرَثَنَا الْكِتَابَ الَّذِينَ اصْطَفَيْنَا مِنْ عِبَادِنَا فَمِنْهُمْ ظَالِمٌ لِنَفْسِهِ وَمِنْهُمْ مُقْتَصِدٌ وَمِنْهُمْ سَابِقٌ بِالْخَيْرَاتِ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ The ظَالِمٌ لِنَفْسِهِ They fall under here. Some of them are going to enter hellfire. They're believers like him. The difference is that the believer doesn't stay in hellfire forever. He will be taken finally out of the hellfire. Whereas the disbeliever will stay there forever. The hadith is going to mention this to us. Naam.
ثم يقول الله تعالى أخرجوا من كان في قلبه مثقال حبة من خردل من إيمان.
Allah will say, take out anyone who has it in his heart حَبَّةٌ مِّنْ خَرْدَلٍ مِّنْ إِيمَانٍ The word حَبْ is the plural, and it is for the بَذْرُ النَّبَات the seeds, the mustard seed that's placed in the earth. That's that size of Iman. Anyone whose heart has that much in their Iman, in their hearts, that's small. Take them out of the hellfire. Anyone who has what? This much of Iman in their hearts, take them out of the hellfire, where they're going to be taken to Jannah.
فَيُخْرَجُونَ مِنْهَا قَدْ اسْوَدُّوا فَيُلْقَوْنَ فِي نَهْرِ الْحَيَاةِ أَوْ الْحَيَاةِ
They will be taken out of the hellfire, قَدْ اسْوَدُّوا They became black, charcoals, burnt. You know if a person gets burnt in the fire? They're burned out. فَيُلْقَوْنَ And they will be thrown into فِي نَهْرِ الْحَيَاةِ A river. And they will be washed, which then will give them life again. Once a person gets cleaned, their skin gets cleaned, and everything gets cleaned again, they breathe again. Life comes back to them again. That's what happens. So that it's got some hayat is said. This is a shak from the narrator, which is Malik ibn Anas, by the way. And Imam Malik, but this doesn't harm the narration because whatever the two of the meanings that it is, it doesn't really change the meaning. Hey?
فَيَنْبُتُونَ كَمَا تَنْبُتُ الْحِبَّةُ فِي جَانِبِ السَّيْفِ
Does it say حِبَّة or say حَبَّة?
حِبَّةُ
أيه.
فِي جَانِبِ السَّيْفِ أَلَمْ تَرَ أَنَّهَا تَخْرُجُ صَفْرَاءَ مُلْتَوِيَةً
نعم. Just like, what do you call it? The plant that's on the edge of the... water, and the water keeps going over it and it becomes yellow, sah? And it blossoms. They're going to just come out like that, blossom and look good after they get washed. This hadith has many fawaid in it. Number one, الرد على المرجئة, refutation on the group, the deviated group, the murji'a, who said, لا يضر مع قول لا إله إلا الله عمل. They believe that you come with لا إله إلا الله, nothing's going to harm you. That's what they said. These people said لا إله إلا الله and then the hellfire. So they did get harmed, right? They said, La ilaha illallah, ma'a dhalik, they're in the hellfire. So that's refutation on them. Are you with me? Some people of Ahlul Tawheed are being taken out of Jannah. This is refutation on the Murji'ah. Okay. Also, it's a refutation on the Mu'tazila and the Khawarij. Which is what? The Mu'tazila and the Khawarij. And what is it, brothers? That the person is going to stay in the hellfire forever. They're taken out of hellfire. So the Murji'ah, the refutation on them is what? How did he go to the hellfire in the first place? For you guys were saying that he was a believer and he shouldn't have. He went to the hellfire. Can you not see? Refutation, they're gone. And the Mu'tazila and the Khawarij refutation is, how did he come out? Does that make sense? Because the Khawarij believe he went in, he doesn't come out. They agree that he's going to go to the hellfire. But they just believe he's not coming out. The Murji'ah believe he doesn't even go to the hellfire. Are you with me? Ahlul Sunnah al Jama'ah said what? They go into the hellfire and they come out after a while. Does that make sense? So they took the path which is wasat. Now if you look at the Khawarij, as they say, and ulama mentioned, that the Khawarij as a group, they have never had scholars. They've never had it. They're never the type who have scholars and people of knowledge and understanding and comprehension. They never had it. The only group that's had that is the Mu'tazila, the Murji'ah. They had that. The Mu'tazila. So that's why the scholars sometimes they don't even speak about the Khawarij. Because all they are is emotional individuals who have no diraya and no fahm of the nusus. As for the Mu'tazila, they brought out scholars. Zamakhshari is a Mu'tazili. He's a Mu'tazili, and look at his kashaf, the sharah, his tafsir of the Quran. Scholarly approach they take. Are you with me? And they really came out at the time of Imam Ahmad, rahimahullah, right? The issue of Khalq al-Quran, the Quran being created. They had school, they had scholars, they had people they put forward. Sahih? That's how they were. So, but the difference between the Mu'tazila and the Khawarij is what? The khilaf between the Mu'tazila and the Khawarij is khilaf lafdi. It's just terminology, it's just wording differences. Because what happens is that the Mu'tazila say, if you do a major sin, you're not a believer nor are you a disbeliever. So you're in between that. There's a station they called it, manzilatun bayna al-manzilatayn. There's a station in between that you're at. The Khawarij on this flip side, what they said is, no, you're kafir. But they both agree on the hellfire, you're going to stay in the hellfire forever. So this one just puts a question mark on your religion. And this one fully tells you that you're a disbeliever. But they both agree on what? That you're going to stay in the hellfire forever. In the dispute between the Mu'tazila, a deviated group, and the Khawarij is basically khilafun lafzi. And it's not haqiqi. Does that make sense? The other benefit that we take from this is what? Al-Imam al-Bukhari and how he deals with the narrators that are spoken against. And we gave two answers for it, right? That you can find more details in Kitab. Hadyusari ibn al-Qayy ibn Hajar al-Asqalani. He writes pages explaining everything. And proving how, because he followed up one narration after the other. One after the other. One after every narrator that's been spoken against. No.
And in the same chapter, narrated by Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiyallahu anhu, that Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, while I was sleeping, I saw in a dream that some people were displayed before me wearing shirts, of which some were reaching up to the breasts only, while others were even shorter than that. And Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu anhu was displayed before me wearing a long shirt which he was dragging. The people asked, how did you interpret it? I.e., what is its interpretation, O Allah's Messenger? He, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, replied, it is the religion.
حدثنا محمد ابن عبيد الله قال
عبيد الله
عبيد الله قال حدثنا إبراهيم بن سعد عن صالح عن صالح عن ابن شهاب
محمد بن شهاب الزهري
عن أبي أمامة بن سهل أنه سمع أبا سعيد الخدري رضي الله عنه يقول قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بين أنا نائم
This hadith أبي أمامة سهل بن حنيف is the son of a companion. His father is a companion. He heard Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, Sa'ad ibn Sinan, we mentioned him. يقول السين قال رسول الله that the Prophet said بين أنا نائم whilst I was sleeping. So these scholars, they said, when was this? When was the Prophet? Was it the night of Isra wal Mi'raj or was it actually a sleep? The strongest is that أن هذا رؤيا is a sleep منامية. The Prophet was actually sleeping. And the Prophet's sleep is not like a normal sleep. It's a revelation. صح? ولذلك حديث عائشة رضي الله تعالى mentions الحديث أبو عائشة رضي الله in كتاب البدء الوحي بخاري brings it that the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام before the Quran اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق came down on him for 6 months. Allah تبارك وتعالى used to send revelation on him whilst he was asleep, and whatever he saw in the dream will always take place in front of him. That's what Aisha said. You find that in what? Kitabu? Bad al-Wahy, Sahih al-Bukhari. So this is a dream that the Prophet used to see alayhi salatu wasalam. And he said, I was sleeping and I saw this in my dream. Revelation. This is a wahy. Because what's the evidence for that? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam, he said alayhi salatu wasalam, al-anbiya la tanamu a'yunuhum. Prophets, their eyes don't sleep. Sorry, tanamu a'yunuhum, their eyes sleep. وَلَا تَنَامُوا قُلُوبُهُمْ, but their hearts don't sleep. Prophets, their eyes go to sleep, meaning they close their eyes. But their hearts are working, they're not sleeping. And this is مِنْ خَصَائِصْ الْأَنْبِيَاء. This is the distinct characteristics Allah gave to the prophets. Just like the earth doesn't eat. إِنَّ اللَّهَ حَرَّمَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ أَنْ تَأْكُلَ أَجْسَامَ الْأَنْبِيَاء. The earth cannot eat the flesh of the prophets. If you undig the Prophet from his grave today, it's like he got buried yesterday. Nothing's changed. It looks the same. The earth does not eat him. Whereas us, the earth eats us until what? عُجْبُ الذَّنَبْ. Do you know the عُجْبُ الذَّنَبْ is what? Is it what's called? What's it called? That bone in the back, the tailbone. No, don't say tailbone. It means
coccyx.
Tailbone means we come from monkeys, huh?
The coccyx.
The coccyx. Ah, nah.
بين أنا نائم رأيت الناس يعرضون عليه وعليهم قمص.
The Prophet said, whilst I was sleeping, رأيت الناس, I saw the people presented in front of me. بمعنى, what is the word عرض علي, يعرضون علي, placed in front of me? It means يقفون أمامي. They were placed in front of me. They were standing in front of me. Another view says يمرون علي. They were going by me. They were walking by me. Those are the two. And the word يُعْرَضُونَ can take both meanings. هيا. وَعَلَيْهِمْ قُمُصٌ. And they were wearing قُمُص. قُمُص is جَمِيعُ قَمِيص. جَمْعُ قَمِيص. It's the plural of the word قَمِيص. Garments. نعم.
وَعَلَيْهِمْ قُمُصٌ. مِنْهَا مَا يَبْلُغُ الثُّدِي.
And from amongst them, مِنْهَا, from the people I was that were presented in front of me, the ضمير of مِنْهَا goes back to the ناس. The people. From amongst them was what? مَا يَبْلُغُ, that which reaches الثُّدِيَّ. ثُدِيَّ means the breast, the chest. The قَمِيص actually just reaches the breast, the chest. نعم. Because it's very short. In other words, قَصِيرٌ جِدًّا, and it can't reach elsewhere. نعم. So that means their awra showing, by the way. If it reaches there, that means awratu مَكْشُوفَ. Their awra is showing. And they are not mastura, they're not covered. Naam.
وَمِنْهَا مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ.
And then from them are those who are a bit longer. Naam.
وَعُرِضَ عَلَيْهِ عُمَرُ بْنَ خَطَّابِ.
Then from amongst all of those people, Umar comes out. He's shown to me in front of me. هيا.
وَعَلَيْهِ قَمِيصٌ يَجُرُّهُ.
Umar has a qamis that he's dragging his qamis. People are reaching here, a bit lower. Umar is dragging his one on the ground. That doesn't mean men are allowed to drag their garments, by the way. There's no evidence in this. Naam.
قَالُوا فَمَا أَوَّلْتَ ذَلِكَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ.
فَمَا أَوَّلْتَ means أي بِمَا فَصَّرْتَ. What explanation and interpretation have you given to this dream? Now that you saw Umar dragging his garment, and that the rest, they had their garments short, and their awra was showing, what is it that you... What's your interpretation? What meaning did you get out of this? And the Prophet responded by saying,
قال الدين.
He said, Umar's religion is long. Strong. The other people, their religion is small. It's not fully covering them. Whereas Umar, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, his religion, he's strong in his iman. And he's strong in his faith. And that's where Bukhari is using a babu tafadul ahli al-iman fil a'mal. Umar's iman is higher and stronger and more powerful than the rest. The benefits that we take from the hadith is, of course, number one, that the people in their religion, they are not of one level, and they are of different levels, and their strength and their power and their strength is different. Are you with me? This also benefit we take from this is what? Fadila, the virtue, azimatu wa manqabatu kabiratu li Umar ibn al-Khattab, the virtue that Umar has, and his status and his position, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Also, the thing that we take from this hadith is what? That something can be differently observed in a dream than what it is observed outside the dream. Sah? In the dream, Umar's garment pulling is praiseworthy. And it was something good. It showed that he had an iman. But the same, if he was to do it outside, it would show his iman is low. Which is a man cannot have his garment below his ankles. As the Prophet ﷺ said, مَا أَسْفَلَ مِنَ الْكَعْبَيْنِ فَفِي النَّارِ. Any garment that's below the ankles is in the hellfire. Any garment that's below the ankles is in the hellfire. So we have here that Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, in the dream, he's actually been praised for having a long garment. And that showed his strength and his power of his iman. Whereas outside, if he was to do that, it would show deficiency and weakness in Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu in terms of his iman. ولذلك, he himself, whilst on his deathbed, Abdullah Umar ibn Khattab, while he was on his deathbed, a boy entered onto him. And he saw him. Umar was on his deathbed, he's about to die. And he said, Ya Bunayya, O my son, irfa izaraka, lift your izar up. Take it up. For verily this is more pure for your garment and for long lasting for your garment. You're destroying your garment, it's gonna finish like that. So Umar radiallahu anhu wouldn't pull his garment. And he never pulled his garment. Are you with me? His garment was half his shin, as it's mentioned in his biography. Now.
Chapter. Al-Haya is a part of faith. Narrated by Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhumah. Once Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam passed by an Ansari man who was admonishing his brother regarding Al-Haya. On that, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, leave him, as Al-Haya is a part of faith.
Babun Al-Haya'u min al-Iman. Haddathana.
Al-Imam al-Bukhari rahimahu Allah, here he says, Babu chapter, Al-Haya'u min al-Iman. Ay, Al-Haya'u shu'batun min shu'ab al-Iman. That the Iman is a branch from the branches of al-Iman. And based on the hadith that we took before, it is from the, which of the branches does it fall into? كماله الواجب. Meaning, if you leave this, you are ظالم لنفسه. A transgressor who has exceeded his limits and sinning. Does that make sense? But that doesn't mean it is أصل الإيمان. It doesn't mean your religion goes because of it. So Bukhari is giving us شعب الإيمان, the branches of الإيمان. نعم.
حدثنا عبد الله بن يوسف قال أخبرنا مالك بن أنس عن ابن شهاب عن سالم بن عبد الله
عن سالم بن عبد الله بن عمر بن الخطاب and he's going to say عن أبيه meaning his father عبد الله بن عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله تعالى عنهما may Allah be pleased with him. سالم is من علماء التابعين الأجلاء. He's from the notebook تابعين and he's from the فقهاء السبعة. He's from the seven jurists of Medina. نعم.
عن أبيه أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم مر على رجل من الأنصار وهو يعيذ أخاه في الحياة فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم دعه فإن الحياء من الإيمان
فإن الحياء
من الإيمان.
Why is it حياء؟
إن
اسمه إن. أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم came by على رجل أيمان من الأنصار from the people of Ansar. وَهُوَ يَعِظُ أَخَاهُ and he was advising his brother, admonishing his brother, telling him his brother off by saying to him, why are you always shy for? Why are you always so shy like that for? Stop being shy, he's saying to him. أَخَاهُ فِي الْحَيَاءِ فَقَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ the Prophet said to him, دَعْهُ leave him alone. فَإِنَّ الْحَيَاءَ verily shyness مِنَ الْإِيمَانِ is a branch from the branches of al-Iman. This hadith shows us that a person, these are the benefits that we take from the hadith. So the first, what was the word? Da'ahu, ay utruku, leave him alone, leave him. The benefits that we take from this hadith is the virtue of shyness, and that it's a branch from the branches of al-iman. The second thing that we take from it is that the person who's giving the reminder and who's trying to admonish a person sometimes may even be wrong in his admonishment and his advising, right? He might be incorrect. And it doesn't mean just because he's the one advising the other one, he's necessarily always right. So his kalam and his statement is observed by looking at the textual evidences, the kitab and the sunnah. فَمَا وَافَقَ الْكِتَابُ وَالسُنَّةِ is taken. ولذلك, that's why Imam Malik said, كُلُّ يُؤْخَذُ مِنْ قَوْلِ وَيُرَدْ إِلَّا صَاحِبَ هَذَا الْقَبْرِ. Everybody's statement is either taken or rejected. Except the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, no, we take everything he says. No, if no, but everybody else who's advising you, if what he said was in accordance to the kitab and the sunnah, it's taken. If it goes against the kitab and the sunnah, we'll say, Jazakallahu khayran for your good intentions, but what you're saying is wrong. Also, the third benefit that we take from it is, the one who is advising or admonishing somebody, if he gets it wrong, he should also be advised. And he should be told that what he's advising is wrong. That shows that the advising is not restricted to a person over another person. That everybody can advise another person.